Okay, guys, so we're here to discuss DevOps on OpenStack. So we got a distinguished panel here. I'd say one thing, the first question, the first discussion, we'll kind of run through a list, but this is really to stimulate the discussion. So by all means, raise your hand and ask questions. The panel is really here to answer your questions and not mine. We'll start with a quick introduction. We'll start with from here. So Kobe, you're the first.
Okay. Hi. So my name is Toby Holzer, and I lead the DevOps groups in Liveperson. We are OpenStack users. Started in Liveperson 2 years ago, and since then building the DevOps team and trying, and it's work in progress, to bring the DevOps culture into Liveperson.
I'd like to add that Kobe is also the only one that is a customer, not a vendor, here on this panel. So. Awesome.
Yeah, RackSpace in a way is also a user. I'm saying RackSpace, even though it's a vendor, it's also a user.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. That's just joking. So my name is Sebastian. I'm the founder of Scalr, which is an open source project to manage applications that are deployed on the cloud, specifically managing them in a DevOps way that conforms to IT policies for the enterprise.
Hello, I'm Marc Clouet. I'm the head of the DevOps and Automation Advisory team at RackSpace. This team is international, and it covers both RackSpace Private Cloud and DevOps methodologies. So we try to embrace this and tell this story about DevOps to our customers so they can embrace this as well.
Hi, I'm Mark Ram. A couple years ago, I worked at a media company, and we had a lot of, let's say, DevOps issues, not success stories at the beginning. Developers would develop an application, spend a lot of time working on it, and then right before we tried to deploy it, we would hit this wall that was ops. We solved a lot of those problems in ways that were very specific to our own little world and built tools because we needed them. And when I got the chance to come to Canonical and work on Juju, which I thought was a tool that would help lots and lots of people do DevOps better. I jumped at that chance. So.
Hi there, Azmir Mohamed. I run products at CloudScaling. We help customers build private clouds based on OpenStack. And I'm involved with DevOps in two ways. One is that's how we stand up customers' infrastructure, is using Chef. So we spend a lot of time with that. We wouldn't be in business if it weren't for DevOps. And the second way is we get a lot of customers either coming off of Amazon, so DevOps is the way of life for them, or we have enterprises coming to us and trying to figure out how to deal with OpenStack. We advise them in terms of how they would use DevOps on OpenStack.
Good. So I think we have a lot of good perspective. My only problem as a moderator is that two Marks, Mark with a C and Mark with a K, are sitting together. So when I'll say Mark, I'll need to somehow say Mark with a C or K. So Mark, the first question is for you. What is DevOps?
A lot of people define DevOps as, you know, using this tool or that tool or using this process or that process. But I define it as development and operations working together through the entire life cycle of a project, from project initiation all the way to deployment, and doing that in a structured and meaningful way. And I could talk a lot about what structured and meaningful means, but probably who here is a developer? Who here is the operations person? Okay, we've got a few operations person, people who are also developers, because I know them. You know, software teams collaborate, and they have tools to do that. They have version control tools, they have IRC, they have ticket trackers. Collaboration and software development teams are not version control tools and ticket trackers. That is the tools that we use to get the job done. And there's DevOps tools, and we'll talk about those. But the fundamental thing is getting operations and developers to work together in a meaningful way.
Sebastian, I think that you wanted to say something about that.
Yeah, I was just trying to find out an angle that was diplomatic here. it's about collaboration and all. But I also think there's... You know, traditionally in the enterprise, there's this wall that Mark talked about, and that's very, very much true. But there's this other cultural change where developers get operational burden and people in operations have to start developing code. So it's not just the two departments just talking to each other. It's also about a responsibility change in the roles in the different parts of the organization.
So, Kobe, I think that you had some experience about, you know, the difference between culture and tools and how they play together. Do they help each other, or is it mostly culture, mostly tools? How was your experience in Liveperson?
I want to refer before that. For me, as a user, as a customer, DevOps is a little different because we have the operations, the traditional operations, and we have R&D, very two big groups, and the gap between them is very, very big. And you can't take all operations, traditional operations, and make DevOps out of them. So there was a very big gap, and we needed to talk with the dev, needed to talk with the operations, and see how to close this gap, because R&D wants their services in production, and operations need to understand what R&D wants and take it to production. So we needed to bring the tools, the right tools, the orchestration, the automation, the deployment, the provisioning. So we closed the gap with the tools and with the ability to speak dev and operations.
So is that mostly culture or mostly tools in your view?
Does it work? Yeah, there you go. So I would say that DevOps is both about culture and tools. But for me, the important part is culture. So everyone thinks it's about tooling, make things faster by tooling. But if you don't break that wall, as Sebastian said, it's very important that it's a culture change. So what you're doing here is that you're getting the best abilities of software lifecycle and software development that have been practiced during the years, and you apply that to operations as well. And then you get the best practice of operations, so it's analytics and load capacity and all these things, and you pass all this data to the developers, because this way developers don't feel the disconnection of their code. They don't feel like they're not responsible anymore of their code as soon as it's in production. So they feel the continuous life cycle of their code, and they can see where the code is failing and where the code is suffering in order to make it better.
So how much the developers and the operations are using the same tools, for example, thinking about breaking the wall?
Well, so, I mean, earlier I said it's all about culture, and I think that's true, but software development teams are all, software development collaboration is all about culture. Open source projects are cultural entities, but I cannot imagine going back to a world where we developed Linux by passing around patches on mailing lists. Version control and Git has changed the way that Linux software development worked. It changed the culture. It fundamentally reshaped the way that we think about software development collaboration, and I think deployment automation, while not absolutely necessary, is the fundamental tool of development operations. If things are not automated, and if the operations and development teams are not collaborating around that automation, then there's a problem. And I think the next step is equally important. If there are not analytics about the wellness and functionality of code, if, for instance, you're trying to get as far as continuous delivery and pushing multiple times a day, you have to have metrics. You have to have tools that say, hey, this is not working. At SourceForge, we knew within a couple of minutes of pushing code whether we had a decrease in ad click-through rate. We knew within a couple minutes. And that's not something you can test for, because that is sort of a random user behavior.
So basically what you're saying is that culture is important, but without tools, it's much harder to change the culture if both groups are using completely different tools.
You almost can't. Yep. And I think having the right tools is really important, and that's why I took a job working on DevOps tools and service orchestration.
So how many of the developers in your organization, for example, are using monitoring on the desktop in the same way that they're using monitoring on their production, speaking of tools?
Yeah, so I'm not a developer, and thank goodness I'm not. But we have our Jenkins board on a big 42-inch screen, and I go in every day and I look for the green light. And because we deploy about 50 times a day on our infrastructure to make sure the code, right? And so for me, without that, we wouldn't be in business, right? So we use that, developer uses it. We have a very, very small QA footprint. So everything's about automation, and without these tools, you know, it's not gonna work. So. You know, I agree with you. I can't see a world where they're you know, when you go back where you're passing stuff around, we would never release code.
Yeah, so I'll repeat my questions on the tooling side, maybe for Mark and for Sebastian, is that how many of the developers today are using the same tools on the desktop than the one that the operation guys would use in production?
Well,
what's the gap there? I mean,
in my world, I run the Juju project. And Juju includes the Juju GUI. The GUI is deployed in production as a service that our ops people run. The charm around that is developed by the GUI team in collaboration with the operations team. They are deploying the charm in LXE containers every day as part of their development process with the exact same scripts that we use to deploy it to production. So that is maybe, and there's other teams that are doing similar things. It's maybe half. The Juju process itself, we don't deploy to production. We release as packaged software. And so that has a different set of requirements and is less DevOps-y.
Let me tell the story of a talk from one of the operations guys at Twitter. He gave this talk, I think, in 2010. And I think it illustrates really well the DevOps mindset. So at Twitter, they have you know, billions of requests a day for all sorts of different things. And they push code out all the time. And inside the Twitter offices, they have these boards that instrument a whole bunch of metrics. Some of the metrics they look very closely at is the number of error rates, like 500s and things like that. So when and they're able to correlate that to code pushes. So you have this timeline where you have code pushes and you have different events like a new switch was down. Like there's a whole bunch of things that are correlated on that same timeline. And when they see variations of average memory utilization or average CPU utilization or increased error rates, they're able to correlate that back to a certain event that happened on the development side. And what's interesting is how they tackle that problem of trying to identify what caused that involves a lot of people in the organization, and not just the person who pushed the code. It could be something that happened upstream a couple hours ago, but had this effect that kind of snowballed and only appeared 2 hours later. So it's this collaborative effort around instrumenting everything that the entire organization is doing to be able to pinpoint the root cause of problems.
Good. Now, there was a point before I asked the audience for questions. There is a point, Azmir, that I think you mentioned about the fact that, and now come back to OpenStack, the OpenStack angle. How critical is DevOps into OpenStack? And you mentioned, I think, two stories as far as I can. One of them is users who wants to move from Amazon to OpenStack, and the other one is people who moves from VMware to OpenStack. How critical is DevOps in OpenStack?
For AWS, that's just the way of the world, right? There was no ops guy. So the developer needed to do everything him or herself. So that's an easy conversation for me to have. We also get a certain number of people from VMware coming, and for lack of a better term, they're asking for open source VMware in OpenStack. And we shut that down very quickly, right? That's not the way to do things. And so we have a message that says, you pack cap and growth. You've got an existing application that runs well on VMware, keep it there. You want to build your new applications using DevOps on the infrastructure, on the OpenStack infrastructure. And you can do really cool things with it, right? So you don't want to conflate the two because we spent a significant amount of time up front explaining to people why is it, right? Because ultimately for them, from a human standpoint, somebody's going to lose a job, right? What used to take 10 people to go do, DevOps now can take one, maybe less person to do, or the developer can do it themselves. So it's a very controversial message, but that's progress for you.
So basically saying that if you move from VMware to OpenStack, you need to change also some of the practices and way of doing things and not just move and expect it to behave like in VMware. Are you experiencing the same thing yourself, Kobe? Because you have a VMware environment and you introduced OpenStack as a way to reduce the VMware cost?
I think that as an OpenStack user, it was not possible if we didn't have the DevOps skills. We started with the OpenStack very early in Diablo, and it took from us a lot of effort getting into the code, see the problems, see what else need to be done, and fixed it. And you can't have an OpenStack cloud without all the tools
But you had a VMware environment before, right?
We had a VMware environment, but it has nothing to do with it. Because when we decided that we're going to go virtualized as much as possible, so we decided to drop the VMware and start with OpenStack. Mm-hmm. So we didn't have to move things for the VMware because it was in a very small footprint. And we started small with the OpenStack, built our confidence up, and got where we are today with 1,400 instances. But I think that being a DevOps skills are a must for OpenStack. Maybe less today because it's becoming more easier and there are more vendors and help that you can get. But still, OpenStack...
Why is it critical to be a DevOps in OpenStack?
So
why is it critical to be in DevOps or have a DevOps skills?
Because, again, OpenStack alone is not enough. You need to have all the tools for the change configuration, for the automation, for the auto-scaling, for the monitoring. Okay, so you can't do it without the DevOps skills.
So, I mean, we've just said, you said DevOps skills like five or six times. And what the hell does that mean?
Okay, that's a very good question. Like you said at the beginning, DevOps for everyone is something that how we see it. For me, DevOps is being able, of course, to see and write code, and more importantly, come from the operations world.
Yeah, so there is a question from the audience. First, yeah.
Right.
That as a customer, because I think DevOps as a customer is a much different sort of paradigm because each of those teams might, you know, be progressing in their DevOps model. But I'm really more interested in kind of understanding the challenges of folks up there in the audience or in the stage that are running clouds and have consumers. How are you running your platform? In other words, how are you building OpenStack? And when you had a challenge of 6 months cadence releases from the community, some of the stuff you might be doing yourself because the community is still not there. Right.
Yep, so that's an excellent question. How do you build OpenStack? I'll start actually with Mark, because he's from RackSpace and they're building OpenStack at scale.
So what are we doing at RackSpace? And this is a good question. The important thing is that OpenStack is such a vibrant project and so in such a speed that at RackSpace, what you're trying to do is keep as close to trunk as possible. So for example, right now at RackSpace, we have several of the OpenStack companies that we're just 2 weeks behind trunk. And this is fairly important. In order to do this, what you need to do is have a very, I would say, DevOpsy team in a way that culturally there's a different kinds of attitudes and methodologies towards that, but at the same time, the tools are very important. So it's both a question of having the right people with the right tooling around them. And with that, as I said, keeping two weeks behind trunk is very hard. It is not an easy task. So we're trying to do our best on that. It doesn't come without some sacrifices, but that helps us being as up to speed on bug fixes and new features as possible.
Yep. Yeah, just let's see if anyone else.
I was going to talk about the difference between below the cloud and above the cloud. Obviously, the cloud itself is an application that runs on some servers, and there you can think of the developers and the operations of the cloud collaborating to make that happen, make that work. They described a model where they have sort of continuous delivery that's slightly lagging behind trunk. That is the sort of nirvana of DevOps, is to have continuous delivery and have it work well. But it's hard, and in some ways, like, for depends on your application, depends on your workload, whether that is worth doing. But I want to go above, talk about above the cloud for a second. I think a lot of interest in cloud, and in my experience in enterprises, a lot of developers in enterprises go to Amazon because they can get around operations. It's not DevOps, it's no ops. It's screw the ops, I don't need you, I can do it all myself. That is a different thing, that is not DevOps skills, that is cowboy. I think most cloud deployments are cowboy. Whether that's a good thing or a bad thing is yet to be determined. I think there's a place for cowboys.
Did that answer your question?
Yeah, but I think that think that the continue the nirvana, the continuous integration, the ability to we at Comcast have a fairly large deployment, it's growing, and we have multiple zones, multiple data centers, and some of the challenges that we're facing is how do we stay within a certain range of close enough to nirvana, but also
right.
The fact that we have a lot of those cowboy teams above us that are becoming deploying on our cloud, so we're kind of becoming a little bit
right.
Like Amazon, and that we have a lot of customers, and how do we upgrade without having disruption? So,
one interrupt here just before you answer. How many of you here are building OpenStack or building or consuming cloud? So we'll start with building. Raise your hand. Oh, that's a good crowd. Okay, so we'll know how to route the questions mostly into that. How many of them are using OpenStack or consumer OpenStack? Obviously, all the rest. Oh, so you're also building and okay. Okay, so let's continue. So at least that gives us some ratio.
I think that the fundamental things that are important for above the cloud are important below the cloud. First of all, we need to recognize that operations people, while they are risk averse and while they have been perceived as a wall and the handoff between development and operations has been painful, that is a structural problem because they're a different team. Handoffs between teams are painful. I mean, just look at Olympic, they pass the torch, it falls.
Yeah, so I want to have more questions from the audience,
but there are two fundamental skills in my mind that apply both above and below the cloud, and that is repeatable, testable deployment and monitoring and testing of things in a test environment in as close to production as possible of a simulated production environment as close as possible. If you have those two things and you're doing them regularly, you're doing DevOps.
I also have infrastructure automation, because you can do all of this and still have to go through all the ticketing cycles.
So could you repeat the point that you mentioned with the mic? Where's the mic? So okay, borrow this one.
I just wanted to add that I agree with these two points.
You're from Sriram?
I'm Sriram. I work with ThoughtWorks.
Okay.
We're a continuous delivery company, and I consult on continuous delivery. I just wanted to add to your two points and say that it's also important that you add to that list infrastructure as code as well. Because if you, and with a view to having self-provisioned environments, because if you don't do that, you may have all the deployment automation and all the great monitoring, but you still have to go through the regular IT channels to get your environments up.
So how much OpenStack, in your view, is ready for that rolling upgrade of the infrastructure itself? I'm sure that you experience different...
It's a very big challenge for us to upgrade the OpenStack every time. In fact, when we started with Essex in production, we had to use the Nova Network, of course, but when we wanted to move to Quantum, we had to build the infrastructure from scratch and then migrate from the Essex to Folsom. So
what
we
actually did is build a parallel environment with a new version.
We had to build a parallel environment because we did a lot of tweaks and a lot of workarounds with the Nova Network to put it inside our layer 2 infrastructure, so we couldn't just upgrade and use Quantum. Mm-hmm. And the network was a very painful thing in Essex.
And Mark, you're not using Quantum right now in RackSpace, right?
We're using parts of Quantum. So we wrote a plugin for Quantum called MVP, which ties with our hardware. The thing for me about cloud and about how DevOps relates to the cloud, though, is that cloud helps have very high iterations. So it commoditizes the server as a service, let's say. Mm-hmm. So then you stop having the sacred server that you shouldn't touch because otherwise everything breaks. So everything becomes idempotent, which is very important. Everything becomes repeatable. So anytime that you face a problem, normally the best case is just to redeploy, redo, get a clean slate, so what we call solid state deployment. So be able to create new platforms on demand with these resources that you have available.
Got it. I wanted to give Sebastian some time to answer that question as well. Do you have anything to add to that?
No, I wanted to get Kobe to have expressed his opinion on this.
Okay, got it. So Mark, I'll get to this, but I want to get more questions from the audience.
Sure.
Yes.
So I have a friend of mine,
Get closer, because we don't hear you, and we'll give you a mic. I think that would be better.
OK, so I have this friend of mine. And for lack of a better term, he's working in an environment where they're building a product. So this is, you know, in a year's time, this is going to be, you know, shrink wrap products. It's not operations as we have an operational website type of a thing. But he has a boss saying, hey, this DevOps thing is cool. Everyone go, you know, out and buy the Phoenix project and read it. OK, now go. Any advice for my friend?
Mark, I think that's a question for you, man.
Well, right. So we write a product. Well, we have several products. We have Ubuntu. That's a product. We have a OpenStack distribution. That's a product we release every 6 months. And we have Juju. That's a product that we release on a regular basis. You can still do the thing. The two things that I said are really important. Continuously redeploying the service, continuously testing it. You can do that, whether you have customers using it or not. You can do that internally. And having that stuff all automated in a repeatable, buildable way, that is something you can do. And then the third thing you can do is pull in operations people to talk about, and this is something that actually Juju can do better, to talk about operations guides, the kind of things that operations people care about over time. Because while we like to think that we live in the cloud and everything is throwaway, sometimes it really does matter if your service goes down.
Yeah, so I just wanted to make sure that there is more tools, not just Juju, that does those type of things. I think that...
I wasn't even talking about tools. We don't use Juju to do DevOps for Juju.
Yeah, it was just a segue, just to make sure that we're not coming here with a conclusion that if you want to do DevOps, do Juju. So coming back to Sebastian.
maybe a good way of seeing this.
Yeah, just I wanted to interject a question to you that I think you mentioned. One is, what is the minimum requirements for implementing DevOps? Is there such a thing as minimum requirements to implement DevOps in OpenStack? And if you can also relate to the questions that I think was laid out, if there are between the versions of OpenStack, like the versions progressions, what are the tools that actually makes OpenStack better, and if there are any recommendation to use Heat or use some of the new features that are coming with OpenStack that will make DevOps simpler. So if you could talk about those two points, please.
I guess the overarching method is how does operations and development talk to each other? Sometimes it can be over Skype, sometimes over IM, but it can also be over an API. And in this case here, when your operations team is providing an API to your developers for them to do their stuff, then that's a method of communicating that's well understood, documented, assuming you do all that stuff. Now, if you have an OpenStack cluster where some of the services are have a dependency on stuff that does not have an API, then you have this communication issue where for some things you make API calls to get more instances or more storage, but for some other things then you need to walk down the hall and go to ServiceNow and file a ticket to get something instantiated. So I just wanted to outline that there's this communication problem.
And can you give an example of those? You know, like you mentioned, I think, a few of them before.
All right, let's say that you are not using Cinder for some reason and you're using some network attached storage. And every time you launch an instance, you want to have some network storage to it. And so then you file a ticket in ServiceNow and you then wait a few weeks to be able to get that volume that you're then going to be able to attach mm-hmm. to your instance. That's very unagile.
Okay, and any recommendation for the new tools that is coming with the new releases of OpenStack? Are they making the life, like maybe Azmir, you want to touch on that, about Heat or about any of the framework?
Yeah, so well, I want to go back to the under the cloud because we
sure.
use all the time. So we do, you know, engineering does a deploy to our four labs every day, and we turned a corner because we actually signed up private clouds for customers. We actually had our deployment guys who are effectively ops people use the same engineering tools, right? And the reason why was because we reduced human error, got it up and running. We have a week to go in and stand up a cloud. And so you know, we got them turned around, but it took 6 months for us to get there, right? So I think how you get people to adopt is really to share, to really drive it forward, but ultimately sort of threat of something, right? Which is you're going to have to get your stuff done in a week, or you're on your own. In terms of tooling, right? So we use Chef, right? Because we used Chef 3 years ago and it worked just fine for us. So I'm not saying that it's the only tool out there, but that's what we use and we're very comfortable with it. But people are also using automation for applications. So the one thing that we see a lot on the developer side is people wanting to build these apps that, you know, the nirvana of self-heal, right? So you don't need VMware HA anymore. You have the application do the availability part, and then auto-scale, right? Whether it's private cloud or public. And so that's when, you know, we don't really prescribe what it is that they use, but effective requires some sort of modern tooling to sort of make that happen.
Yeah, so before that, there is more questions. Let me
refer to that before the question, please.
Yeah, I'll just pass the mic while you do that.
How many Chef users do we have here? Please raise your hand. How many Puppet users? I think I see more Puppet.
Yeah.
Okay, so I can say that for us in Liveperson.
Salt. Okay.
How many Ansible?
Yeah. Ansible? How many people using Ansible here? Quite a bit. Okay, nice.
So Salt, for us.
How many people using Salt? Just to complete that? Okay. Sure.
Okay, so Puppet for us was a very, very big thing. We talked about the gap between operations and R&D. So Puppet was the thing that helped us a lot to bring those two together. Because we introduced Puppet, and we had to teach our R&D to write in Puppet. So today, every deployment, every R&D know how to write in Puppet and deliver is a new upgrade, whatever, to operations that also know how to use Puppet and deploy with it.
Yes, so I think you and Sebastian are saying the same thing, and I think all of you would agree that tools helps to create that communication between the groups. It's all about the tools.
Culture is important.
Let's not get too much into that.
You bring it, they will come.
Okay.
So I was wondering...
Your name again? Your name?
Hi, I'm Joris. I work for Cisco.
Okay. Go ahead.
I was just wondering, when we're talking about DevOps, how in the investment of doing DevOps pays off and what the scale of the project needs to be before it starts paying off, and whether that is something that you could build a kind of repeatable process to, right? What we're talking about, things like continuous integration. Well, sometimes we have very small projects too, right, that only require like 2 man-weeks of work just to integrate 2 existing systems. And while it might still be something that is very important and will be used by a very large user base, but in terms of code, it's not something that is very complicated or hard to do.
That is an important question. I forgot the name of that guy who wrote the book, Taste of Taste, but he was actually referring to that in one of his recent blog about the fact that if you don't get your kingdom in order and you try to build DevOps, you're actually going to get a diminishing return. And what he was referring, for example, is testing feedback. So if you don't have, for example,
if
the testing, for example, takes a long time until you actually get the feedback loop, then you're doing a continuous deployment, that's not going to work, because then the time it would take you to actually get a feedback for that wouldn't work. So there is, so you need to get your kingdom in order before you can actually implement that. And the parallel that he was using is, you know, building a production line where you have all the goods in place, but the shipment doesn't actually get, and at the end of the day, what you get is a lot of warehouse where you need to put all the goods that you're producing. So I answered part of it, but I think the question is really for the panel here. Do you want to comment about what do you need to actually implement DevOps as a substrate?
So I would say that it depends on the size of the team, but the sooner you implement DevOps, the better, right? Because there's things that you design in the beginning when you're small and you're not too pressured to grow up. And those things can carry technical debt. So do you guys, anybody doesn't know here what technical debt is? So, yeah, okay, perfect. So you need to make sure that you take the right decisions, and then you can start implementing the tooling, and you can start implementing especially the communication methodologies between your team as the team grows up. Because as the team grows up, normally in all startups, the economy pressure grows up as well, financial pressure to deliver results. So you have less time to react, and this is where DevOps is very good. It helps you react faster to these kind of things.
So is there minimum requirements to start DevOps? I mean, what do you need to have in your organization or in your infrastructure to actually start DevOps, Mark?
I would assume that if we do understand DevOps to be a cultural thing, then culture is much harder to change at 50 people than it is at 5. So if I would do that as soon as you possibly can, because it's only going to get harder unless you're downsizing.
So basically saying, bring it and they will come, or do it and they will come. Something like that.
There are a couple of considerations. I think the size of your team, like the bigger it is, the more established your processes are, the more important it is to have started DevOps early. If you know that it's never going to grow beyond one person working on this application for 1 week, there's no such thing as DevOps because there's no operations. There's no handoffs. DevOps is how you, like, handoffs are evil. The more handoffs you're going to have, the more important DevOps is. And then the second thing is, like, it costs time. It costs effort. It pays back over time. If you have a project where you're going to continuously deploy, we're going to deploy multiple times, that is when it's worth investing in it. Like, sometimes it's worth writing software and writing libraries and doing all that. Sometimes you just write a bash script and throw it away. And then the other thing that is sort of ancillary to all of this is sometimes you don't want to do DevOps. You just want to get a product. You want to have someone have solved this problem for you and just use something that works. But that is a whole separate story. Like, you don't have to solve every problem. You don't have to do DevOps for everything. And one of the things that OpenStack, I think, has not done is become a product. It is still very much a set of tools that you have to integrate. You have to do this stuff. There are people who are trying to make it a product. But by default, if you just do it yourself, you got to do DevOps.
So Mark, how much heat, for example, in your view, is changing a lot of the challenges that I think the other Mark was referring to? Is that a solution? Is that a promise that is not yet fulfilled? What do you think? Is that something that if I'm trying to implement DevOps on OpenStack, I should start with?
So I would say that one is consequential of the other. DevOps is all about the challenge. So it's about the velocity of your development. How fast can you get your product to the market? How early can you get that into the face of your customers? So having cloud helps you potentiate that. It helps you turn faster and make things faster, and don't worry too much about having to order the new server, have to wait a couple of weeks to rack it up, so you can immediately get all that. So at RackSpace, what we normally say is that you want to own the base and then rent the spike, right? So you want to own your base, you want to control that, but as soon as you have a spike, you need to react to that faster than having to get more computing power.
So should I use Heat if I want to implement DevOps, or should I use some other tools, OpenStack?
We advocate for all tools, right? So we advocate that Heat is an amazing tool for orchestration, but we also advocate that it's also important to keep the state of your service. So what we normally recommend is to use Heat, and on the back end of that, use something like Puppet or Chef as well to maintain the state.
Okay, so we need to wrap up, so I'll finish with a round question for the panelists about each one of you, one recommendation for those who wants to implement DevOps on OpenStack, for building OpenStack or for using OpenStack. So choose one recommendation and we'll finish with that.
Evolve or die, you gotta do it now, right?
Yep.
That's how you develop things in the 21st century.
Yeah.
Automate and repeat. That's it.
I would say embrace the culture that your people in your company have, and at the same time, make it faster. So that's the main message.
Use Scalr.
Again, automation as much as possible. And of course, auto-scaling, auto-healing, everything with auto is good.
And I will finish with the fact that I think with OpenStack or in cloud in general, there is no option but implementing DevOps. So I think with that, we'll end. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you very much.